Have you ever been obsessed with anything? Some of you may be obsessed about girls or boys. Some obsessed about Lakers or Clippers or football. But when you think about things that you're obsessed about, you always think about it. You always dwell on it. And then we talked about, you know, Psalm 63 today. A lot of times we focus mainly on, you know, the beginning verses, but you see the picture of David. He's obsessed with God. You know, he thirsts for God. He thinks about him in the morning, and even when he wakes up in the middle of the night, he thinks about God. He clings to him, he yearns for him, and it's because that's what's in his forefront. And a lot of us, we talked about today, is we can say, yes, I feel that same way, or I wish I felt that same way. But how does your obsession show up? You know, if you're a fan of Lakers, or you're into a girl, whatever, a boy, you say, I'm really into you or into this, but if you never show it, that's not really an obsession. That's kind of just intention. And today in Romans, we're going to look at how your life shows your true colors. It's not so much, oh, I'm a Christian, or because I have thoughts of being, you know, doing good things or doing things for God. It's whether you do it or not. That's the measure. And we've been talking about the wrath of God, how judgment is given, rewards and wrath. But how is that determined? It's really by how you live. So I invite you to turn to Romans 2, and we'll come back to Romans 2 and look at what is the standard of measurement. Is it what we intend to do, or is it what we do? And so let us stand and turn to Romans 2. We'll read from 5 to 16. And let God's word minister to us as we hear it. But because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath, when his righteous judgment will be revealed. God will repay each person according to what they have done. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew and then for the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For God does not show favoritism. All who sin apart from the law will also perish apart from the law. All who sin under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but it is those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. Indeed, when Gentiles who do not have the law do by nature things required by the law, they are a law for themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts. Their consciences also bear witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them and at other times defending them. This will take place on the day when God judges people's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. You may be seated.
We thank God for his word. Let's pray that his Holy Spirit will teach us and apply it into our heart today. Lord, we are in Romans, and it's a wonderful, wonderful book, wonderful invitation, Lord, to feast upon your word. We pray that you will give us the appetite today, that will give us the know-how to process the truth that you've given to us. Teach us, your Holy Spirit, lead us to your truth. Help us to apply the principle into our lives and into our world. Help us to walk in obedience. We thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me quickly review to you what we did last week. Lam already connected to us a little bit there. But Paul is presenting the gospel of salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 1 to verse 18 to chapter 3 verse 19, He is showing why we need to be saved and what we need to be saved from, and that is from the wrath of God. And he is proving that everybody is guilty, no matter how God measures us in different criteria. We are found guilty and short of his glory. And at the end, all mouths will be shut and nobody is with any excuse. And the principles that God is using to for judgment is truth, works, and law. And we already covered truth and works. And today we will cover that part of the law. And God's judgment finds everybody guilty of eternal damnation. And everybody is in need of God's grace. Last week we proved that our works are the basis of God's judgment. He appointed a day of judgment, and the Lord Jesus Christ will be the judge. And the time for the judgment will be at the second coming when he comes. But the final judgment for all the unbelievers will be at the white throne judgment at the end of the millennium, the earthly kingdom. Jesus ushers in the eternal state, and so the judgment will be rendered for everyone that is outside of him then. For everybody, the basis of judgment is works, and that's surprising in some way, but it is the truth that the scripture repeat to us. Said that there's a book of life, meaning those who are saved, they are saved by grace, written into the book of life by God's choice, by God's election, by God's grace. But everybody is measured by the books of works. So everything that we have ever done, every word that we have ever said, is recorded. And on the basis of those records, we will be judged. The judgment will be rendered completely and without partiality. But the thing we noted that we are not saved on the basis of works. We are judged on the basis of work. We are not saved by works, but we are saved unto God's work. And so, because we are saved unto God's work, to do God's work, therefore the measurement is just to look at the work and you know the person is saved or not. Not just like one, 2 days, but the pattern of life. A person works to reveal whether he has been saved. Because the work is the evidence of salvation, the evidence of eternal life. The work indicates the basic value or the orientation of life. The priority, you know, if you look over your life, or we look over our lives, we will see that. The work of the redeemed, scripture tells us that will show that they seek God's glory, seeks God honor, seeks eternity value in eternal value in God. That is, a person who are saved, the persons who are saved seek God's approval, seek first the kingdom, seek heavenly blessings, the whole orientation of what they are seeking. So we can see that the priority of life that show up in reality of putting Christ first, kingdom first, heaven first, eternal value first, show the redemption, evidence of redemption. But the evidence of the unsaved life is also can be seen by his work. And scripture sum up everything concerning the unbeliever, unsaved life in one term, and that is self-seeking. And that should always a measurement for us to reflect upon, because ultimately an unregenerate man is totally wrapped up in himself. Self-seeking is evidence of a great evil that Paul was talking about, and that is the exchange of God at the center for self and for created things. And so when we no longer seek God first, we seek ourselves first, and that prove into our works. I mean, our work might look very, very noble, but if it is for self, then it shows the evidence that we have replaced God, exchanged God at the center, and that is the evidence of unregenerated man, unsaved person. Self-seeking is the evidence of great evil, of exchanging God for self at the center of life. So we are measured by how we live and what we live for. And so that leads us into the point today that God's church with perfect justice, perfect impartiality, and the standard now for us to measure, for Him to measure us, is His law that He's given. So let's look into the outline and just make note of the three points to anchor our thoughts. The standard of God's judgment, the law, and it's all talking about not redemption here, but it's about judgment. So I use the word perish because in verse 12 open, we can see that for all who have sinned without law will perish without law, and those who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. And so from there we get the 3 points here. Number one, men perish apart from the law. Men perish apart from the law. Number two, men perish under the law. Men perish under the law. And number three, men perish on judgment day. Men perish on judgment day. Men perish apart from the law. Men perish under the law. Men perish on judgment day. So let's start with number one, and that's on verse 12 that I just read. For all who have sinned without the law will perish without the law. So as we said that Paul is setting up the big argument or the presentation of the truth from verse 18 of chapter 1 to verse 19 of chapter 3, trying to show that all men are dead in sin under the wrath of God and without excuse. And he is making the point that when God applies his standards of judgment, in relation to knowledge or to works or now to the law, all men are found under judgment. And it is an important point for us to understand because as part of applying the law or without law here, it has direct bearing on us as individual and as a church in the work of the gospel. For we would consider as those without law before we came and believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, because Bible perspective we are the Gentiles, but more than that, for those who know the Vietnamese background, the gospel did not come to Vietnam until 1911. So the question is, what about those who lived before 1911? Who never had a chance to hear the gospel? Are they, any of them saved? And if they are saved, on what basis? And if not, on what basis? Is it fair if they are lost without the gospel? So that's a question. And what about those who are now living in our time but never heard the full presentation of the gospel? Can they be saved? But closer to home, for each one of us, question like, okay, now when we're talking about God's law, God's revelation, if we have the Bible and we don't read the Bible, then are we under law or without law, and how is God going to judge us? How about our friends? Friends that we know but we don't witness to, what happened to them? And how does this principle apply to us? So a lot of things here that we can see. But let me reconnect with Paul in his flow of thought in verse 11, where he's talking about God's impartiality in judgment. So he talked about the works, and he talked about the works as evidence of those who are saved. Verse 6 said, God will render to each person according to his deed, to his works. And for the believer, those who are by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. That's what God gives to those who seek him and show that in their life, in their priorities. And for the unbelievers, as we just mentioned, who are selfishly ambitious or who are self-seeking, then wrath and indignation. And he said that his judgment is accurate without any fault. And he said that for there is no partiality with God, verse 11. So when Paul said God is without partiality, he used a word that God does not respond to face. You mean appearance. The word impartial is the word receive plus the word face. So he does not receive anybody on appearance, on the outside. So God is not impacted or impressed by, you know, by our cries, by our tears, by our emotions, by whatever that we do. Sometimes, a lot of time, we will come to God and we say, you know, if we pray, quote unquote, sincerely, if we pray with tears, if we pray with a lot of emotion, sometimes if we say it out loud, you know, then it somehow impacted him, somehow it moved him. He said, no, nothing moved him. He is a judge without impartiality. He will judge on facts only, on the evidence of reality of transformation within. So that's inform us even in our walk with him. But I want to note the scripture talking about his impartiality, so that when he moved into the verse 12, and he said that all who have sinned without law will perish without the law, we understand why it is so. So the impartiality is God's character, and it shows even when Jesus is on the earth, his enemies recognize it. In Matthew 22, verse 16, when they come to him, they say that, teacher, we know you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You are not swayed by men, because you pay no attention to who they are. I think that's very interesting and very instructive. He said, you are not swayed by men. You don't care who they are. And that's something we should note about God. Is he's not swayed by our tears, our emotions, by the things that we think affect us and affect one another. And Peter wants us to understand that when he presents the gospel, he wants people to understand that God is impartial. So when he presents the gospel, the full gospel to the Gentile the first time in Acts 10, verse 34, he begins with saying that, I realize now how true that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. He said that he's not partial. Anybody who responds to truth coming to him, he will receive. So we are informed on how God deals with us as well. So the only reason we don't reap destruction is because grace covers us, the result and the consequences of our sin are now taken care of in the Lord Jesus Christ. But God is impartial. He does not favor us for any reason, but because we are covered by Christ and by grace, so that we escape his condemnation. But Galatians 6, verse 7, inform us in the way that we deal with him, so that we don't presume on grace. He said that, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. So he said, God is not mocked, meaning he is not to be found inconsistent. He will be impartial. If you sow something, you will reap that the result of that. And like I said, the reason we don't reap destruction because we are covered by the grace of God in Christ. But the result of life will also show the impartial character of God. And so Peter reminded us that this truth should strike fear in our heart, you know, healthy fear, reverence fear, so that when we come to God, we know that he treats us impartially without, you know, our appearance, without anything like that affecting him. Peter said in 1 Peter verse 1, chapter 1, verse 17, since you call on a father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear. So he said, to know that, then he said, remember, you are only a stranger on earth, meaning you're not here to stay forever. Understand that. And so you're going to face God, and he will measure your life on earth impartially. take that into consideration, because at the end, judgment will be complete. So God judged on the basis of work, on the basis of deeds, meaning he bring judgment upon the evidence of life, not the intention of life, not the emotion of life, not something that we wish to do but never have time to do, sometimes that we desire to or want to, but indeed we have other priorities. He takes none of that into consideration. He said, give me the evidence, I will judge on the evidence. And on the evidence, scripture said we are all condemned, because none of us do the perfect work, the righteous work that he requires. And so it become the total indictment against all people, and that is on the measure of works. He finds that everybody is self-seeking, nobody seek God. And that is the condition of man. There will be objection, because somebody will say, well, if God judge on the basis of works, now some people who know more about him, therefore their works is different, and others, they don't have the opportunity to know about what is right, what is wrong, then how can their work to be right with God? And so how can God be impartial? How can God be fair? And so that's where now moving into verse 12, under the law or absent of the law, Paul is arguing that God is completely fair, God is completely impartial. When he judge according to his law, or in the absence of law, he will judge on the law of the heart. So he does not favor people. He does not hold people responsible when they did not know as much as somebody else who is more responsible. So we see bound up in that statement, God is impartial, or there's no respect of persons in God. It's the fact that he will judge righteously and fairly and with justice. So the question is, does God judge everybody the same? The answer is no. He will judge everybody according to the light that each one receive. Paul is making that argument here, and that for people who have the law will be judged according to what they know, and people who don't have the law will be judged with what they don't have, or what the information they have. So let's move into that and see the basis of judgment of God in terms of people who don't know the word, don't have the gospel, don't know the law. And we learn this so that we understand how God works, and that let that inform in our own life for us in terms of judgment, but also in terms of the work of the gospel that is entrusted to us. So verse 12 again, for all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. So what people without the law, meaning without the knowledge of God's law, without the revelation of God in his word, in his text, in the Bible. And so here, Paul argued that for them, God will show his justice, his impartiality, and that he will judge them according to what they know. So the phrase without law is that the people without the written law of God, not that they don't know what's right and what's wrong, they just don't know the law of God, the Mosaic law, or we can say generally they don't have the scripture, they don't have the Bible, they don't know anything about the gospel. Now it is a term generally designated for the Gentiles, meaning those who don't have the written scriptures. They have no prophets, they don't have biblical writers, they did not have the written revelation of God so that they can read, avail themselves to the knowledge of God. Like I said, partisan mean that they are without any law, because later on he will argue that they have the law written into their heart. In verse 14, let's just jump there, make a reference, and we come back to that later. Said that, for when the Gentiles do not have the law, do instinctively the things of the law, these, not having the law, are law to themselves. In that they show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience bearing witness, and their thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them. He said that they have the law called conscience, that God has written into the, to their heart. But they are without the law, the sense of the written text, the review word, the gospel, meaning the people who are born, raised up, and in their life they don't encounter the word of God, the Bible. They have never heard the name of Christ. They don't know anything about, you know, the life and work of the Lord, nothing about the cross, nothing about the resurrection, nothing about God's plan. Those people who don't have the Bible, or have never seen the Bible, have never heard the gospel presented to them. Now, if we think about that, throughout history, most people would fit this category. Most people would fit under the classification as not having the law, the word of the Bible. Most people coming to the Word don't even hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in modern time, we have, you know, the spread of media. We see the translation work of the Bible. There's a great effort to translate the Bible to get them out in print and distribution. But most people who have lived on the face of the earth have not had the law of God, have not encountered the scripture. So will God judge them when they never had the law? The question is, will God judge them? The answer is yes, He will judge them. He will judge them according to the fact that they don't have the law, but He will hold them responsible. And what's the result of the judgment? So when you say that when God judges people who without the law according to what they have, the assumption is that there is some way that they will be saved even outside of the knowledge of the law. That's not what the Bible said. The Bible said they will perish without law. And the statement is very clear in verse 12, for all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. It's clear, but we didn't expect it that way. We tend to think of maybe God will give some leeway somehow, but He said that, you know, because God is impartial, He judges according to the evidence of life. And the evidence of life for those who are outside of the law without the gospel still bring condemnation upon them. Like I said, you know, we tend to follow our hearts and try to reason in terms of universalism, that somehow at the end those without the law or without knowledge of the gospel will be saved somehow. Scripture said no, they are not saved, they will perish. So we need to understand that, because that will change our perspective concerning the outlook for us into the world, into the gospel work, into the work of the Great Commission, but also in the way that God measures the life. We tend to be sentimental, and we tend to reason with our feelings and without fact. That's why Scripture said God, There's no partiality with Him. And therefore, those who have sinned without the law will also perish. Now, the reason is that the question is, do the people without law sin? Do they sin? Well, obviously they sin. And with law or without law, people sin. So they do sin. And all of them sin, and nobody is without sin. Therefore, the knowledge of God is included them. In verse 18 to 20 that we read previously, let's come back and read that. And the scripture established that on the very minimum basis of understanding that God provides to everybody, that is sufficient to judge them, to bring them under judgment. Go back to chapter 1, verse 18 to 20. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power, his divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through that has been made, so that they are without excuse. The answer from Scripture is that they don't have the law, but they have the general revelation. They have enough to lead them to God and to salvation. But because they rejected God and suppressed the truth, suppressed God's revelation in unrighteousness, what is made available for them to know God, they reject that, and so they are without excuse. And people without the law perish. The word perish is a very strong word, and it's the word to be destroyed, to be put to death. But it's it has a very interesting connotation. It's a compound word with the prefix of off or cut off, and the word ruin. So you are cut off, and you are left to ruin. It's a picture of the fruit falling off the tree and laying on the ground and become rotten on the ground. So it is a very vivid picture of a condition of a sinner. It is cut off from the source of life that is God and become rotten and ruined and destroyed. But it also has the notion of permanency to it. It cannot go back on its own. You know, the fruit after falling off the tree cannot reattach itself to the tree. So it has that sense of permanency. Once you fall, you are where you are, and you become rotten, and you become ruined and destroyed. So people are cut off from God because of their rejection of God, and in that condition they perish. They cannot on their own come back to attach themselves back to God because the condition of sin in their life. But let's press the point a little bit more and say how ruin is ruin. You know, their life will be miserable, but will God save them at the end? That's a lot of the argument of universalism, meaning at the end God will save everybody, because how can he, being a loving God, leave them to be ruined out of, you know, no fault of their own? Scripture said that's not true. It's not that they are without fault. They have suppressed the truth concerning God. They have rejected God. They have exchanged God for themselves. They have removed God out of the center of their life. They have placed themselves. They have become self-seeking. They have put idol in the middle, and therefore they are without excuse. And so God brings judgment without partiality. So that on the evidence of their life and their rejection of God, judgment comes. But how ruin is ruin? I want us to note that. Now, the same word is used for Antichrist. I want to show that in Revelation chapter 17. If you turn there, it was talking about the beast, which is Antichrist in the context there. And it said that the beast which you saw once was and now is not will come up from the abyss and go to his destruction. It will go to the same word, to where he's perished. Also in verse 11, the beast which is Antichrist, who once was and now is not, is the eighth king. He belongs to the seven and is now going to his destruction. So if Antichrist is going to destruction, go to perish, perish himself, and that is the same fate of the people who are without law and rejected God. Now, to be really sure, Revelation 19, verse 19 tell us what does it mean by going to the place of destruction? But the beast was captured. Beast, it's a reference to Antichrist, and with him the false prophet who had performed the miracles on his behalf. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of fire, a burning sulfur. So going to destruction is going to hell, going to the eternal hell. So perish without law means you are going to hell. And we need to pause a little bit to think about that. So the question, will those people who never heard the gospel, never heard Christ through the gospel, will they perish? The answer is yes. What does perishing mean? It means the same thing to them that it's meant when it was said about the Antichrist, that they will be cast into the lake of fire. They will be cast into hell. Why? Because they have sinned. They have suppressed the truth. They have exchanged God for themselves at the center of their lives, and they are without excuse. Now, Paul is make that argument, number one, for us to understand the condition of the world, understand the judgment of God, understand the depth and the intensity of God's wrath. I think we tend to fail to understand all this truth. We have presumed quite a lot on how God gonna deal with the sinners, but God has given us this example so that we understand the next thing is that people with the law will fare even worse because they have the law and they are found rejecting God the same way. Now, we will get to that in the next point. I just want to make that connection. And if the people with the law, meaning the Jews, is getting worse, the people in the church will get even worse because we have the complete law. We have the complete Bible. We have the complete evidence of the cross, the resurrection. We have everything that that God will reveal or have revealed. And therefore, the argument is if those who have sinned without the law will perish without the law, how much more so those who with the law will perish with the law. An example that Jesus gave about the servants who were neglectful of the duties when the master is away and got caught when the master returned. He said that to the disciples, concerning us being ready when he himself returned. And so this whole argument, the whole logic is applicable to us. Let's read in Luke chapter 12, verse 47-48. It said that the servant who knows his master will and does not get ready or does not do what his master wants will be beaten with many blows. But the one who does not know and does sin deserving punishment will be beaten with a few blows. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. So the application of this principle that God is impartial and he's not swayed by man, he's not swayed by our cry and fall, foul, and thinking that we deserve differently. He said, I'll judge on the evidence of your life, what you know. And the basic judgment is that whether we have replaced God at the center of life, whether we are self-seeking or we are seeking God's glory, seeking kingdom first. And when we put it in that term, it gets very, very close to a lot of us sitting in the church with presumption that somehow we are here and therefore we are saved. And Paul is trying to knock that down. He's been trying to knock that down ever since chapter 1, verse 18. And he said, there are those of you who think you are moral and good and decent, and you think you're going to escape the whole thing. I'm telling you, you're not, unless you cast yourself in the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ, and not just because you assume so. Your life has to show that evidence that you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, that you are indeed redeemed. How? Well, he said, look at your life, look at your work, because that's how God's going to look. He's not looking at your presumption or what you argue about. He's going to look to see if you seek his glory, seek his honor, seek immortality, seek the heavenly blessing and eternal value, or are you just self-seeking like everybody else? So come back to the Luke example. You know, both servants are all beaten because they all found deficient in their duties. The ones who have more knowledge is punished with worse than the one without. But they are both punished. They both perish. But the greater punishment comes to those who know the most. And so those who sin without the law will perish, and the punishment, it will be damnation, but it will be lesser than the other group, which is the one who perished with the law. We'll get to that in a moment, but I want to pause a little bit and answer and come to the related question that we need to understand, and that is the necessity of the gospel presentation. Is evangelism necessary to bring people to salvation? Is it necessary for people to hear the gospel, to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, to be saved? Now, people without law, meaning they have not heard the gospel, they have not heard about the Lord Jesus Christ, they don't have the Bible. So how does salvation come to them, or how are they going to be saved? And what are the responsibilities that we have to the world of people who do not have access to Scripture, or who do not have any connection to the gospel? Well, number one, we want to establish that evangelism is necessary to bring people to salvation. It is necessary for people to hear the gospel and to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. There is no other way. Even though we may wish other ways so that, you know, our presumption can be satisfied, but the Scripture does not allow that for us to get that position. People need to know about Jesus Christ in order to be saved. But number one, Paul is talking about the universal depravity of man, that everybody reject God. In the knowledge of creation, they reject God. In the knowledge of the law, they reject God. And so every man is condemned. And we want to see that in Romans chapter 3. Let me just read for you from verse 9 to verse 12. It's a lot more than that, but I will just start there. So he's arguing, and he said, you know, are we better than they? Are the Jews better than the Gentiles? And he said, not at all, for we have already charged that both Jews and Greeks are all under sin. And it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good, not even one. So the Bible is very clear. Anybody gets saved because of their response to the truth given to them? Anybody? Gentiles? None. Jews? None. Not even one. Not even one single soul seeks God. Not even one of them do good. Everybody is condemned. So everybody, when given the choice, they reject God. So people said, you know, we don't have a choice. Well, Scripture said everybody is given the choice, given sufficient knowledge to respond to God, and everybody with whatever level of knowledge, of light, everybody rejects God. None seeks God, none respond to Him, with law or without law. So the conclusion is that everyone perishes forever. So salvation is the gift of God, and by God's election and by God's choice. Since all men choose to reject God and die eternally, God in His sovereign grace chooses to save some and gives them the gift of salvation. And we have that in Ephesians 2. Let's turn to Ephesians 2, verse 4 and 5, 8 to 9. Let me just read that for you. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgression. It is by grace you have been saved. In verse 8, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourself. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. So it's very clear that salvation is not by human effort. It's not something that we do, not our response, not our work, not anything that is from us. It is a gift of God. It is given by grace and grace alone in the Lord Jesus Christ. So salvation is a gift from God and by God's choice, not originated from man, because all men chose to reject God and are dead in sin. But the important thing is to note this. God also ordained the means of salvation. God chooses man out of his sovereign will, out of grace. We say, well, that's not fair. Well, fairness or justice already done. And that in all the lights given to man, all the truth given to man, they all reject God. They all replace God with themselves. They all exchange God for idols and created things. They all suppress the truth. So when we talk about justice, God said, on the basis of justice, it's done. God has judged impartially, without partiality. God has done so, and all men are found guilty, and they all perish. So the salvation is the gift of God, given by grace, by God's sovereign choice. But how does he give salvation? How does he invoke salvation? How does he bring salvation? He ordained the means to give the gift, and that is through the gospel. It is through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that God brings salvation as a gift to those who he has chosen by grace. And that's what we mean by special revelation, meaning specific revelation through scripture, through the gospel, through the proclamation concerning the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So only special revelation concerning God, sin, and the Lord Jesus, that salvation can be given to man. Now there are Old Testament believers who were saved on the same principle of grace. God chose to give special revelation of himself, sin, and the promise of the Messiah and the sacrificial lamb. And you see people like Job, you know, a long time ago, and even people like Abraham chosen. They don't know exactly the detail of the Messiah or Jesus, but they know that God provides substitution for their sin, and by faith they believe in that, and that is counted for them as righteousness. But now that revelation has been given completely, belief in the Lord Jesus Christ is necessary for salvation. And we can summarize it in four provisions. Number one, you believe that the Lord Jesus, you believe that Jesus is the only Savior. Number two, in order to be saved, people must know that they are sinners who need salvation and forgiveness. Number three, in order to be saved, people need to know who Jesus is, and that his death and his resurrection provide the basis of that salvation. And number four, people must place their faith and trust in Jesus as the one and only Savior. Let me read the provisions again. Jesus is the only Savior, proposition one. In order to be saved, people must know that they are sinners who need salvation and forgiveness, proposition two. In order to be saved, people need to know who Jesus is, and that his death and his resurrection provide the basis of that salvation, proposition three. And people must place their faith and trust in Jesus as the one and only Savior, proposition four. So it becomes imperative now for us to understand that in order for people to be saved from human perspective, they must hear the gospel. They must be brought into the knowledge of God's truth. Now, Paul makes it very clear in Romans chapter 10. And it is a familiar text, but we always go there because it's so key to explain how God brings about the gift of salvation. Because right now, even in our midst, there are arguments that, people who are of different faith, they can be Buddhist, they can be Hindu, but if their heart is sincere, if they seek God, if they yearn for heavens, if they want to be free of the burden of sin, God somehow will save them. No, not somehow. This is how, and this is the only way. And that means, we have to be convinced of this truth, because otherwise, we think that the Great Commission work is optional. We think that we don't have duty, we just have option that we volunteer to do. We have calling, and the calling is to be instruments in God's hand to bring salvation to those that God has called out. Let me read from Romans chapter 10, verse 8. But what does it say? The word is near you in your mouth and in your heart, and that is the word of faith which we are preaching. So Paul is saying, the word of faith, and it has to be preached. What is the content? And that is, if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. So clearly you have to know the doctrine of Christ, you have to know the truth concerning Christ, and you have to be able to articulate, proclaim it by faith, who he is, his death, his resurrection, his righteousness, all of that need to be there. For scripture said, verse 11, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. For there is no distinction between the Jews, the Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. For whoever call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So anybody who pray and come to the knowledge of the Lord and call upon him will be saved. But then the question, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? And how will preach unless they are sent? Just as is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news of good things. However, they did not all heed the good news, for Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed our report? So he said that it is necessary to proclaim. And when you proclaim the gospel, it doesn't mean that everybody who believe, but those who would believe, those who God has called out, they will, by that means of the proclamation of the gospel, they will come to faith. So conclusion, verse 17. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. So when the gospel is proclaimed, God through his sovereign grace moves those who would be saved, give them the faith to respond and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the proclamation of the gospel is absolutely necessary for salvation, because the gospel is the means God brings the gift of faith and salvation to those he chose to save. Now, so the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ is exclusive. And that means you have to believe in the Lord Jesus and on the Lord Jesus alone for salvation. And so those who are without law perish without law if they don't know about the Lord Jesus Christ. So when they are without law, they perish. They have to be brought into the knowledge of Christ. So even the familiar text in John 3:16, if you read that in its context, you will see. Let me bring that up for you. that it is not like, God so loved the world, therefore the people in the world will be saved. No, there's a process, and there is very exclusive faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So starting with verse 14, I read to 18. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes will in him have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, same word there, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but the world might be saved through him. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So you have to believe in the name of the only begotten Son. The whole doctrine there, he has to be lifted up. He has to be on the cross. Moses has lifted him up before. Now people have to see that, and that is the love of God given. Whoever believes, whoever come to this knowledge, respond to faith. And if you don't know, and if you don't believe, then judgment is already rendered. He who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So when we read the text here, that in Romans 2:12, for all who have sinned without the law will perish without the law. It's not just for information. It is to know that the world by and large is lost. That all men perish without the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we may say so with the large picture of people we know. We do the work in Vietnam. 92 million people, 0.6% are believers. So it's a very small amount. But let's bring it to home. The work of the church to proclaim the gospel, to evangelize the lost, to make disciples of Christ in obedience, is absolutely necessary. Now, the work of the church means us. So it is done in obedience to the great commission of Christ, but it is also done because we understand that God has ordained the proclamation of the gospel as the means for his salvation. That's how he saved those who he chose to save. And we have the privilege and responsibility to those who are without law to bring the law or to bring the word. And that can be translation, distribution, the proclamation of the Lord Jesus Christ, the gospel of Christ, by preaching, by witnessing, by sharing the gospel. Because, again, they perish without that knowledge. People without law will perish without law. But for us, let's also apply this principle, and that is, we are accountable for the things we know. And some may say, well, I don't know as much as the person next to me. I'm new in the faith, or I'm not raised in a Christian family, or whatever reason. The Lord said, whatever you know, we hold you accountable to that. So those who are without law will perish without law. And so there's no excuse. We are accountable for the things God gives us. No more, no less. But all the things that we have been given a lot, if you think about that. There's no excuse, because God does not allow excuse. So if we measure that, and God is not at the center of our life with the things that we know, then we are responsible for that. Much or little, that's not the point. The point is God at the center of what we know of him. So our works is the basis of that measurement. And the scripture is given us to understand that for the light that is given, it is sufficient for each one of us to take the next step. Even for those without the law, creation is sufficient for them to take the next step. And at every step, when we suppress the truth, when we don't respond to the truth, we replace God by ourselves, by our own priority, by our idols, and that push us outside of the operation of grace. So we really need to answer the question: how do we live with the truth that we know, and where is God basing on what we know about him? So just turn to the person next to you and say, how do you live? But I think more than that, not only that we respond on our, for our personal evaluation, we also have to ask the question, how do people live without the gospel if we don't say so, if we don't proclaim? So as we learn scripture, we know that we are given a huge important task, and that cannot be an optional thing in our life. It is the main call for the church. It is the main responsibility given to all who are in the church. And so if we see our life without connection to this church, it's more damning than just, okay, I just didn't do that part of the Great Commission. It is calling in question the work of our life, the work of the gospel, the work of the kingdom, and we are also measured by the work that we do because it shows the priority of the kingdom and the place of God at the center are not in our life. So Paul is now moving to the next area, that is men perish under the law. Men perish under the law. And this is very simple. As he continued in the argument in verse 12, he said, for all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will also be judged by the law. For it is not the hearers of the law who are just before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. So here we have people with the law, meaning the people with specific or special revelation. For the Jews, it will be the Old Testament. And for us, the church, is going to be the complete Bible. And so the Jews is in view, but we are all in view here in the category of those who are under the law. So under the law here doesn't mean that we are under the old law of the Old Testament, meaning we are under the special revelation that's given by God to specific group of people, the Jews and the church. And it is a huge advantage and a huge privilege. Just talking about the Jews, Paul said, the Jew has a huge privilege and therefore a huge responsibility. He's talking about them in chapter 3, he said, verse 1, what advantage has the Jews? Or what benefit of circumcision? He said, what's the point to be the Jews? And he said, great. He said, great in every respect. The advantage of the Jews is great in every respect. First of all, that they have, that they were entrusted with the oracles of God. And then most important, they have the scripture. They have the Old Testament. It's called the oracles of God. And it is a huge responsibility as well as a huge privilege. In further on, we read this before, but let's just read that again on the privilege of the Jews, because when we read about the Jews, we know that we have even higher privilege and higher gifts from God. In chapter 9, verse 4 and 5, talking about the Israelites to whom belong the adoption as sons, the glory and the covenant and the giving of the law and the temple services and the promises, whose are the fathers and from whom the Christ according to the flesh, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen. So it said the Jews have the privilege. They have the covenant. They are the chosen people. They have the worship. They have the sacrificial worship system. They have the promises of God. And most importantly, they know the Messiah. They know the truth concerning the Messiah. And so those who are under the law, given the law, given the revelation of God, has huge responsibility as well as huge privileges. And that is that's us. We belong to this group, this category. But one thing is important, we need to establish that those who are under the law are not saved by the law. And not saved by the law. The Bible is very clear on the fact that nobody is saved by keeping the law. And so having the law has a different effect. It drives us to grace. It drives us to Christ. And there is also a very clear effect of whether we suppress the truth, whether we replace God at the center. It's made amply clear, a lot clearer than to the pagans, to those who have never heard. We have heard, we have been given the truth, and if our life doesn't show that, then we have, even in worse condition than those who just perish outside the law. And so nobody keeps the law perfectly, nobody completely without sin. And that's why Paul said, and those who have sinned under the law. Now he assumed that outside the law, people sin. Under the law, people sin. So everybody sin. And so those who are outside the law sin, they perish without law. And those who are under the law, they sin, therefore they are judged by the law, and they find condemnation under the law. Let's establish that fact that nobody is saved by the law, by keeping the law, and then we will learn why the law is so important. Romans 3:19-20 make it very clear. This is the conclusion of Paul in the section that we are now learning. And he said that now we know that whatever the law said, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God, because by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. So no flesh will be justified in his sight by the works of the law. So nobody is saved by keeping the law. Galatians 2:16, know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in him and not by observing the law. Because by observing the law, no one will be justified. It's very clear. The law is there, and in theory, if anybody can observe it perfectly, completely, the whole life in the inner thought as well as the outward behavior will be justified, but nobody can do that. Galatians 3:10, make it even more bluntly here. All who rely on observing the law are under a curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one is justified before God by the law, because the righteous will live by faith. And James adds the notion and explains why we cannot keep the law. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. James 2:10. So if we never murder, but we have lust in our heart, we broke the whole law. And so we are judged by the law. We are judged by the law. So now Paul is stripping those who think that they are moral, they think they are good, they think they are decent because they have the law, like the Jews, by extension, like people in the church, because you know we've gone to church, we keep a life that is reasonable. On the outside, we don't murder, we don't do drugs, we don't do stupid things. We think we are okay. Paul said, no, you're not. And that covers everybody. Those who sin under the law will be judged by the law. Now, everybody sinned. Everybody is found guilty. And nobody can be saved or justified by observing the law. And you said, are you going to pound this down to the ground? Well, we would just observe the text. And because we need to have this conviction of our own, because otherwise we can't function in grace. We have to come to the point to really understand that this is about us, and therefore we are driven to the Lord Jesus Christ by grace and know the priority of our life. So what's the point Paul is making? Paul is saying that if those who are without law perish without law, how much more so those of you who have the law and don't observe it? How do you think you're going to escape? What excuse do you have? Because not only you have the law and unable to justify yourself under the law, you are to be judged under stricter requirement, stricter judgment. So those who sin without law shall perish, but they perish with a lesser judgment than those who are with the law. The Lord gave the example for that in Matthew 11, when he talked about the things coming on the judgment day. Let me read for you in verse 20 of Matthew 11, 20 to 24. And this is what Jesus said. He said that then he began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles were done because they did not repent. So now he came and present the gospel, present the truth, and now he brings judgment upon them because they did not respond. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles has occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occur in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Nevertheless, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades. For if the miracles occur in Sodom, which occur in you, it would have remained unto this day. Nevertheless, I say to you that it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you. So the logic of Scripture is that the more you are given, the more will be required. And since you have the law, your liability, the requirement on you will be higher than those who don't have the law. And if those who don't have the law perish without the law, then how is it that you can presume that you can escape? And so again, it comes back to the truth that God judges without partiality. God does not consider outward appearance. He does not consider our presumption. He does not consider our intention. He does not consider our wishes, our plan in the future to do when I'm good and ready, when I'm done with school, when I'm done with my kids, when they're still young. Whatever reason that we give, none of that work. He said, show me the work. Show me the work. So Paul moved into the explanation even more so. He said, for it is not the hearer of the law who are just before God, but the doers of the law will be justified. Now, he used a very interesting word here for the word hearers. He doesn't use the normal word of to hear, but he used the word to hear as a student. Like, you know, you go to student and you go to lecture hall and you sit there. Why you sit there? Because you have a duty to come there and you listen. So he said that that if you think your duty is to listen to the law, and that will be sufficient, then you're wrong. He said, it is not that you respond to the law by hearing is sufficient, but the doers of the law will be justified. So having access to the law, or have access to the Bible, know the truth, is not sufficient for salvation. The question is, not how little or how much you possess, but how do you live? How do you live with what you have? And so Scripture is full of warnings concerning this truth as well. And we'll do well to hear. Now, I realize that in all this section here, we are talking on the negatives, and it is necessary. So Paul needs to establish the fact that we are without hope, we are desperate for Christ. And I think for the church, we need to be on that path. Because a lot of time we are just not desperate for Christ. You know, we may be lukewarm, but we think that's okay. Or we may not be responding to what we know as we must. But we assume that, well, God will allow that to happen. Hearing these things will actually help us. Matthew 7, verse 21, not everyone who said to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. So Paul just repeat that, not that you just hear, but that you do. Now James, James chapter 1, verse 22 is very vivid here. Verse 22, he said, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. We are familiar with that text. Don't just take listening as sufficient and deceive yourself, but he said, do what it says and give the picture. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it said is like a man who looks into his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do it, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. So it said that, you know, you have to do, you have to respond to what you listen to. So this morning we listen to a lot. And you say, yeah, you're quite a lot. But the point is, okay, what are you going to do about it? And for those who listen little, they have less responsibility than those who are given more. So I guess in Anaheim we have more responsibility because we have a lot more given in terms of the word. So we come to the conclusion already from Scripture that no one is justified by the law. And here we say that only not only that hearers don't qualify, nobody can do the law perfectly as required. So everybody under the law is judged by the law. And so nobody is saved by the law. If you have the law and you just hear the law, you are condemned and you perish. If you have the law and you try to do the law on your own and you can't accomplish that because nobody can do it perfectly, you're also condemned and you're lost and you perish. And so what's the point of the law? The point of the law is drive us to grace. Drive us to the point saying that only you, Jesus Christ, can save. Only your righteousness can be given to me. And then we come to him in response to the truth that is given to us. And that is where the gospel bring in. And God in his sovereign will gives salvation to those who respond to the truth that he initiated in their lives. Now, Paul, I'll double back, and I'll just do this quickly here, and say that, in fact, those that we just talk about, they are without law, they actually have the law. And he said the law that is written in their heart, and so he wanted to make that point so that we say, well, you know, they don't have enough information. So Paul said, everybody has the law. Everybody has law, some law outside, some is written law, others have their law written in their heart. But God is fair, he judges without partiality, he is exact, and he will not make any mistake. Those who are, whatever you are given, on that basis you will be judged. So he said, verse 14, for when Gentiles who do not have the law do instinctively in the things of the law, these, not having the law, are law to themselves, in that they show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience bearing witness, and their thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them. We say, what's he talking about? Well, he's talking about just the conscience, how the conscience works. He said, God has written his law into the conscience of every man. Now, it's not precise to the point of the written text, but it does lead man to that direction of what is right and what is wrong. Sufficient to judge his thoughts, his actions, sufficient to accuse him when he's wrong, sufficient to affirm him when he's right. And so man has the law written in their heart. Paul said that for those who are without the outside law, they have the internal law, and that makes law unto themselves. And they prove that in their conduct, because every man is guided by the conscience that God put into the heart. And we know that, you know, we know that. Even when we grow up, before we read Scripture, when our mother said, who stole the cookies? And we just ate the cookie, but we said, I didn't. We know something wrong. And nobody tell us that's a lie, but we know it's wrong. That's why we hide from the truth. Why? Because the law is written in our heart, and so people without the law, they know lying is wrong, they know killing is wrong, they know cheating is wrong, they know honoring their parents is right. They take care of their family, they love their spouses, they help those who are in need, They pay their debts. They don't cut in line when they line up at the supermarket. They drive in their own lanes most of the time. I mean, the people know what's right and what's wrong generally. And that's Paul's argument that by behavior, everybody has sufficient ground to be judged. and so he said that the conscience, their conscience breaking witnesses and thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them. So everybody is under the law, basically. Everybody is under the law. There's those who are without written law that we just argue about in point one. And point two, everybody is under the law, whether it is written law, outside law by scripture, by revelation, or the law of conscience that got written into their heart. But everybody is condemned by the law. So we are driven by desperation to God and to God's grace. But the point to take away here is that we are held responsible for what we know. So at whatever level you are right now in the faith, God said you respond to that you know. And when you don't respond to what you know, then be careful. You are suppressing the truth. You are replacing me in the middle. In the center of your life, you're taking me out. And you are marking your life with self-seeking, which is the mark of the unbelievers. So there's a lot of things to measure for us. But I want to make one last point here, and that is men perish on Judgment Day. And Paul make that clear. He said that on the day when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of man through Jesus Christ. And have he said this? This will take place on the day when God will judge man's secret through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. I won't have time to go into the detail, but we already established that there will be a day of judgment. God established a day of judgment, and Christ will be the judge, and that will be on the second coming of Christ for all believers. The day of judgment is the day of the rapture of the church. God will come, Jesus will come on the air, and will bring everybody who believes to him. And the judgment is on the basis of works, but it is not for salvation, but it is for rewards and for usefulness and service in heaven. So what we do in eternity is determined by what we do here on earth. I hope you understand that. We'll come back to that. That on the basis of what we do on earth, the basis of works, we will be rewarded the capacity so that we can serve in eternity. So I think we use the example that everybody in heaven will be fulfilled, will be filled to the brim. But if your cup is like, you know, the communion cup, he will fill that out for you. But that's all your capacity to serve. Why? Because on earth, that's how you serve. If on earth you serve with a greater capacity and you come to the master and say, here, my 10 talents, I have gained more for you. And he said, I will fill out that capacity for you. But Paul is saying this, according to my gospel, he said, as my gospel declare that on the day of judgment, God will judge the secret of man through Jesus Christ. So nothing is hidden. Everything is exposed. God is not missing anything. Paul is saying that therefore we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home or in the body or away from it. For we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. He said, knowing all this, what do? We are driven to live a life that is pleasing to him, because we know that at the end he will measure our work when we are still in the body. And then he declared, this is the gospel. And so I want us to understand the gospel is this part of the gospel. The gospel is the gospel of judgment. The gospel has that component, and that must be declared. He said, on the day when, according to my gospel, So he internalized that. He said, you know, this is what I live for. This is the message that I proclaim. It is not his gospel as the author, but it is the gospel of his life. And so he said that I've been saying this, I've been declaring this, so you must understand that God will judge the secret of man through to Jesus Christ. So what is the gospel about? The gospel is about future judgment. Paul said that according to my gospel, not according to, you know, some presumption that man will respond only to, you know, a good message. We have to declare the full counsel of God, and the gospel is declared here as the gospel of judgment. God will judge every secret of your heart through his son Jesus Christ. And the gospel is mainly the message about how to be right with God at the day of the judgment. And so what we are missing by and large today is that we're talking about the gospel as solving our immediate problem. You know, how to deal with felt needs, how to solve our issue, how to make us happier, how to function better. I mean, it has that effect in our life. But the main thing is the gospel has to help us or to compel us to live a life that escape the judgment at the end. So the gospel is glorious, is powerful, not to the extent that it solves our problem with depression or, you know, with struggling that we have in this life, but to the extent that it removes the wrath of God away from us, against us, in the last day, in the day of his judgment. And he noticed it is God's judgment. It is God's judgment according to the gospel. So the gospel bring out the picture of the judgment of God. And we are in full hearing of that today. May we also hear that and be convinced of that so that we can also proclaim it for those who need to hear the gospel, because only through the gospel that they can be saved. So all the benefits and all the losses of this life compared to this one statement at the end, that God will judge the secret of man through Jesus Christ according to my gospel. All the things that we may gain in this life or lose in this life, if we don't deal with what the gospel declare, you must be prepared for the judgment day of the Lord. And that is what we need to take home today for ourselves and for those who hear us. They need to be ready for judgment day, and they will well depend on us. And if we are not convinced for ourselves, we will be no help for them. So to take a little time to pray for that with the friends next to you, and we close in worship. We ask the question that with what I know, how do I respond with what I know?